welcome you today. Let's worship our God together. Here we go.
To the amazing one, to the unchanging one, to him the anthem raise, lift up your hymns of praise. For all the things he's done, for all the things to come, to him the anthem.
Oh, today we will
lift up a shout.
Bible says to praise him with stringed instruments and all instruments, so I'm just going to ask Rike to worship our God for a moment.
I am listening, I am waiting. Again, I know that you are watching us from a variety of locations, but I just want to say, can we thank the band, the worship team today? We would do this if we were meeting in person. I'm so grateful for those that are leading us in worship. I don't know about you, but I'm just feeling so encouraged and filled up by pausing to worship the Lord in the midst of everything we have faced this year. We have gone through so much trial and tribulation. At times, it just seems like wave after wave, circumstance after circumstance of things that have come against us. And I just want to tell you that there is a God in heaven who is for us and not against us. He's still with us. He hasn't left us or forsaken us. Our God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. I just want to encourage you with this scripture that the Lord showed me today. And I think it's so appropriate for what we're all going through. It's out of Isaiah. It says, "But now this is what the Lord says. Do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I have summoned you by name. You are mine, beloved church. You are God's. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And when you pass through the rivers, they will not sweep over you. They will not take you out. And when you walk through the fire, you will not be burned. The flames will not set you ablaze. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior." Can we just pause and pray and invite God to be with us in these moments? Well, Lord, thank you so much for your word. Thank you for the worship, Lord. Thank you that we could take our eyes, even just for a few minutes, off the things that seem to want to envelop us and focus on you. And Lord, we pray and ask that you would continue to give us grace to be sustained, to be strengthened, to be full of faith, Lord, no matter what we're facing. There are so many circumstances, Lord, represented by those watching us today. God, would you be with us in every one of them? And Lord, would you be merciful? And would you help those firefighters to put those fires out? Would you give them wisdom and strength, Lord, as they battle the blazes, not only here locally, but throughout California? Thank you, Lord. Thank you that you are a good God and a loving Father. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, thank you again for worshiping with us today. And I want to welcome any first-time visitors or guests. We're so honored that you've decided to join us. Today, we're going to be continuing in our series, Life with Jesus, the Sermon on the Mount. Also, we want to thank you for your ongoing generosity. We encourage you to give online through our Christian Assembly app or our website by clicking on the Give tab. And now, let's turn our attention to the rest of our service.
Hey, everybody. I am so excited that we're going to be continuing on in our series on the Sermon on the Mount. I've invited Coley Kruger, who's part of our pastoral team, to teach us this weekend. For some of you, she needs no introduction, but for others of you who maybe have never met Coley or don't know her, she's been part of our pastoral team for the past couple years, and even recently has stepped into the lead role for all of our women's ministry across the entire life of Christian Assembly. So I'm so excited as we jump into the series, and Coley's going to teach us from God's Word as we continue on in the Sermon on the Mount.
Hello, welcome. Thank you so much for joining us today. My name is Coley. If I don't know you, welcome. I'm a pastor on staff, and I'm so excited that I get to teach in this series. Thank you to Tom and the management team for letting me. We are on the sermon series, Life with Jesus, and there is no better thing I could think of that I'd want to talk about than life with Jesus, because it's so rich, it's so good, it's so real. And so today we're going to be exploring the Sermon on the Mount, which we've been in for the past few weeks before we're the plan for the church series. So I'm excited to be with you today. I'm excited to see what God has for us. And yeah, God's word is alive and active, and I think there's things he wants to share with us today. So praying that you're excited to be on the ride too. And for those of you that are doing our 21-day fast, I hope it's going well. We've been praying for you. Last week, Tom launched us into a 21-day church fast series. For those of you that are doing it, we're in it with you. We're praying, praying that God reveals himself to you in a big way. So to dive in today, I want to start talking about ice cream. And I know that that might mess up some of your fasts, but when I was thinking about the topic of salt and light, all I could think about in my head was salt and straw. So for those of you that don't know, Salt and Straw is my favorite ice cream company. They've started up in Portland, and what they do is they take kind of crazy flavors like bone marrow and cherry, and they make the world's most delicious ice cream. And so I had a friend who was visiting for out of town, and I brought her to a Salt and Straw in Los Angeles. And I was like, you gotta try this. It's crazy ice cream. Sometimes they put things like turkey bits, all this weird stuff. And I'm like, you gotta try it. It's amazing. So I brought her into the ice cream shop, and there was nobody there, which is very unusual. And we walk up to the front counter, and the guy who's working behind the thing, he says, do you guys want a sample around the world? Do you want to try every flavor we had? And we were like, yes, we're going to need that. So anyway, so we proceeded to try every single crazy flavor they had. And the description that he gave with each flavor, they had this one with smoke coming out of it, and he explained the process of how they made it and what it feels like in your tongue when you eat it. And as we were going on, the man who was serving us knew so much about ice cream and the process. And we just said, wow, like, you're really, really good at your job. And he was like, I'm actually the CEO. He said, every month, one time a month, I like to come out and I just like to see the joy that our product gives to our customers. So I actually made all these ice creams. And it was amazing. It was this different experience to see the maker come and explain what he made. And so today, as we go into the Sermon on the Mount, I want us to position ourselves like we're meeting with Jesus. We're meeting with the CEO who sent his one and only son to the earth, and he's going to explain to us what it means to be his people, who it is that he created us to be. And it's exciting because when it comes from the CEO, there's a different level of flavor, knowledge, and just experience that comes with that description. So I'm going to invite us, we're going to dive into the text today, and I want you to think about Jesus coming down and explaining to his people what it means to be a member of the kingdom of God, what it means to follow after him. He's inviting us into this world he created and a story that has a role for you and I. And so what we're going to do today is we're going to explore two roles. I was on Instagram the other day, if anyone follows Overheard LA, and I read this dialogue between a guy and a girl, and the guy said, well, you know, I'm an essential worker. And the girl was like, oh my goodness, are you a nurse? And he was like, no, I work at In-N-Out. And she was like, oh my gosh, you are literally my hero. Yes, In-N-Out workers, you are the heroes. All essential workers, you are the heroes. Why do I bring that up? Because in this Sermon on the Mount, the Beatitudes, God is inviting us to be essential workers in his kingdom. There is a role for you to play. There's a script for you to fill. And God's inviting his people to take their place in the kingdom and be who he designed us to be. So we're going to explore two things today. We're going to explore what it means to be salt and light. Before we dive into the text, would you pray with me? Father, we thank you that you are a God who invites us into the story. We thank you that you don't leave us, you don't forsake us, you don't abandon us. Lord, you want us to be in communion with you, living out the purposes you've prepared for us to live with you. And so I pray that you'd bless this time together. I pray you'd give us insight into your word. And Father, I pray that our hearts would be open to you speaking to us as CEO to employees, God. Will you tell us our mission and what we're called to do here on the earth? In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, so we're going to dive in. We're going to read Matthew starting in verse 13. It says, Jesus is talking to the disciples on the mount. Jesus says, "You are the salt of the earth. But if the salt loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? It's no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled underfoot. You are the light of the world. A town built on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on its stand and it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven." Continuing on verse 17, "Do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have not come to abolish them, but to fulfill them. For truly I tell you, until heaven and earth disappear, not the smallest letter, not the least stroke of a pen will by any means disappear from the law until everything is accomplished. Therefore, anyone who sets aside one of the least of these commands and teaches others accordingly will be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever practices and teaches these commands will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I tell you that unless your righteousness surpasses that of the Pharisees and the teachers of the law, you will certainly not enter the kingdom of heaven." That's the word we're going to dive into today. So I'm going to talk about what Jesus is inviting us into as his followers. And the first thing I believe Jesus invites us into is the role of an essential worker to be salt. Now, some of you are thinking, "Coley, I don't know what it means to be salt." I like to think of it as be salty, not in an offensive way, not in a rude way, be salt among your people. There's three properties of salt that I want to explore today. And I want to remind you that salt is an agent of change. When you add salt to something, it changes something. And I believe what God is inviting us into is to be agents of change in the world. And so the first property of salt, what makes salt essential, is that it flavors things. I was on a walk with Kathy Christopher a few weeks ago. We walked to an outdoor Starbucks and ordered a little breakfast. And as we sat at our little outdoor table, Kathy snuck into her pocket and pulled out this little tissue. And I just watched her and I was thinking, what are you doing? And she opened it and she leaned across the table and she said, "Do you want some salt? I always bring it. The flavoring of this isn't good without the salt." So here's Kathy smuggling in salt so that we can enjoy our breakfast. Salt flavors things. If you've ever seen the show Chopped, one of my favorites, they have contestants come on and cook with really odd ingredients. And because I love the show, I've probably seen, I don't know, 7 seasons of it. And one of the most common complaints of the judges is that the chefs forget to add salt to the dish and it doesn't season it. It tastes bad. And so what happened is they get chopped. Salt is a flavor. It adds to the texture, the dimension, the taste. It flavors things. And so God is saying, "I'm inviting you to be the salt of the earth. Where you go, how you live matters. It flavors the culture, the environment, the surroundings that you're in." When Jesus talks about being peacekeepers, about being poor in spirit, he's saying, when you do those things, you bring flavor to the communities and places that you go. Are you flavoring the kingdom of God for good, or are you flavoring it for evil? He's giving instructions. He's saying, these are all the things, all the ways I've created you to bring goodness to the culture. And when you are peacekeepers, when you are mournful, when you are meek, you bring the flavor of Christ with you, and it makes things taste good. Church, we get the ability to bring the flavor, the seasoning of Christ to whatever situation we find ourselves in, whether it's your work environment, whether it's your home, whether it's your family, whether it's your friend group, wherever you are. Jesus is saying, you are the salt of the earth. Where you go, bring flavor. And don't become like the rest of the world. Don't lose your saltiness. Don't lose what makes you different. Preserve that because it brings good taste. So that's the first thing salt does, is it flavors things. The second thing that salt is historically known for or used in a day-to-day basis is it preserves things, right? If you need to preserve meat, you put salt on it, keep it out. There's lots of things that salt does that it's almost like a healing mechanism or a preservation. God's saying, you are the salt of the earth. I've sent you to bind the brokenhearted, to heal in my name, to bring peace where there is no peace. God's called us to preserve the goodness of his world, of his kingdom. He's saying, if you don't do it, who's going to? we live in a fallen world. We're fallen people. And if there's no one preserving the goodness of God, the inherent good DNA in the world and the culture, it could all go to rot. So God's saying, you get to go into communities and churches and schools, and you get to preserve, you get to bring healing, you get to bring restoration, you get to preserve all the goodness that I created for my people in this earth. You get to be the people that preserve that. Are you preserving the goodness of the Lord where you're living right now? Or have you lost your edge? Have you lost the ability to walk into a place and see a call to help, to be merciful, to forgive, to bring restoration? Jesus is saying, you are the salt of the earth. Preserve my goodness here on this earth. And the third thing we see in salt is, I don't know about you, but salt makes me pretty thirsty. Now, if you've ever been to a Mexican restaurant, you know that they're geniuses. They put these big bowl of chips in front of you. And what it does is it makes you and I thirsty. It makes us want to drink something else. And so restaurants, bars, they're brilliant. They know this. Jesus in John 4:14 said this. He said, "But whoever drinks the water I give them will never thirst again. Indeed, the water I give them will become in them a spring of water welling up to eternal life." You see, God uses salt to draw people to Jesus. Jesus is living water. And people, you and I are born thirsty. We're born craving eternal water. We're born craving Jesus. And so God uses us as his people to make people thirsty. I'll never forget my first experience in a church youth group was when I was 12 years old. And I walked through the doors of this small church in Wisconsin, and I remember feeling something, that the people around me had something that I didn't have. I was 12. I was insecure. I didn't know who I was. I was desperate to belong. I was in middle school. I was awkward and gangly and just wanted to know that I was loved. And I walked into this church and people had something I didn't have. They were loving. They were accepting. They were radiant. They knew who they were, and they loved freely without competition, without manipulation. I was thirsty for what they had. Church, you and I, when we know Jesus, when we have living water, people around us, they notice. They notice, and our gift, our job as essential workers is to deliver them to the source of living water. We're not the source. Jesus is. So when people are thirsty, when they're hungry, we get to direct them to the streams of living water and tell them about who Jesus is. So our first role in the kingdom, coming from the CEO himself, you and I are called to be the salt of the earth. The second thing that Jesus calls his disciples to do is he calls them to be the light. It says, "You are the light of the world. A town built on a hill cannot be hidden." Isn't that a beautiful picture? I got to go to Israel this last year and see right on the Sea of Galilee, the city that's on the hill. And when it's dark at night and you see all the lights, you get this picture of what he was talking about. And it's so different for us today. We live in a world where there's lights on all the times. You and I have phones. We can use our flashlight. There's streetlights. It's very, very rare that we're ever in darkness. But for the people of this time, before there was electricity, before all those things, people who had to travel lived in darkness. I don't know if you've ever experienced darkness. I was in the Amazon jungle once and our guide forgot his lighter. And we spent 2 hours in the complete dark trying to feel and figure out which way the camp was. It's terrifying. If you don't know where you're going, it's scary. And so God calls us to be light. And the first property of light that I want to encourage us to be today is I want to encourage us to be that safe refuge. When I was stuck in the jungle and I was walking through and I didn't know if I was going to make it out, all I could think is, search for the light. If we can find the camp, if we can find the direction, we'll be okay. Jesus calls you and I to be places of security and refuge for people in a broken and tired world. Are we being merciful? Are we being peacekeepers? Are we being a safe refuge for those who have no other place to go? He says, you are the light of the world. You are a city on a hill. You get to direct people, to bring in the foreigner, to welcome those who are far away, and to be a place of rest for them. You and I are called to be a safe refuge for people who have no place to be. That's the first thing we see in about the property of light. The second thing we see about light is that light has the power to expose and bring truth. I recently moved this past weekend. And if you've ever moved, you realize that when you're going through your stuff, there's a lot of exposure. Like there were things I found in my closet that I did not know were there. And when we finally moved my bed, I found a pair of sandals that I was looking for 11 months. Things, when they're brought into the light, are exposed. And Jesus says in John 14:6, he says, I am the way and the truth and the light. You and I get to direct people to truth. And why does that matter? Jesus says in John 6:32, he says, then you will know the truth and the truth will set you free. Jesus's light is a way for us to see the truth. It exposes things. It brings what's real to the surface. It keeps darkness at bay. You and I are called to be people of truth who speak the truth in love, who bring about Christ's light to shed awareness on issues where there is darkness. It is a gift to be truth to others. And the third principle we see about light is that it brings hope. Have you ever heard that saying, I'm looking for light at the end of the tunnel or waiting for it? There is something about seeing light far off that gives someone this sense of hope. Things are going to be okay. There's a plan. There's a direction. It's almost like a guide to us. And Isaiah 42:6-7 says, I, the Lord, have called you in righteousness. I will take hold of your hand. I will keep you and will make you to be a covenant for the people and a light for the Gentiles, to open eyes that are blind, to free captives from prison, and to release from the dungeon those who sit in darkness. God calls us to be hope for the world, to offer them an alternative solution. When there are no answers here on this earth, Jesus says, point them up. Remind them that I've gone ahead and prepared a place for them, that heaven is theirs, that this is not all that there is on this earth. There is more. There's eternal life in Jesus Christ. You and I get the privilege of being light and reminding people that no matter how hard things get, no matter how big the waves are, no matter how scary the storm feels, there is hope in Jesus Christ. You and I get to be those people that direct us to that. And one of the best analogies or ways that I can think about this is you and I aren't called to essentially be the light. We're called to direct people to the light. And so in quarantine, I've started watching Survivor. I'm usually like 10 to 15 years behind on trends. So I just started watching Survivor. And for those of you who have watched it, you know, those of you who haven't, there's this thing during tribal council where everyone has to bring their torch and they say light represents life in this game. But what they do is they carry the fire. And you and I aren't called to be the fire. We're not the light of the world. Jesus is the light of the world. But what we're called to do is we're called to carry the fire, to set the flame that everybody gathers around for warmth and comfort, to lead the path with the fire in front of us. This is the way that we should go, to call hope and to say, there's fire over there. Let's move towards that. There's light. You and I are called to be people that bring people into the light, that direct them towards that. It's a gift. And you and I get the privilege of putting Jesus on display. The other day, I was going through all my old stuff and cleaning some stuff out, and I found this old kind of candle frame that I'd forgotten that I had. It was like a little lantern. There's a little candle in it. And it had been sitting for so long that there was dust all over it. You almost didn't know there was a candle inside of it. And as I took it out and started cleaning off this little lantern thing so you could see the candle inside, I got this picture of this is what it means to be the light of the world. It's not that we are the fire. We're these vessels that carry around the light of Christ in us. And it's our job to make sure that the way we live cleans the glass for other people to see the light in us. Jesus says, it says in the same way, verse 16, in the same way, let your light shine before others that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven. Notice it doesn't say that they may see your Facebook posts, that they may see your bumper stickers, that they may see your political signs. He's talking about good deeds. Are we doing things with our actions, with our lives, that are clearing the glass of our windows and showing people that Jesus is the light inside? He's the reason that we do good things. He's the reason that we're merciful when people might not deserve mercy. He's the reason that we can forgive when forgiveness seems impossible. We're the people that can be meek because we know he's strong. Are we being people that put Jesus's light on display? I went to the beach a few days ago, and when I got home, someone said, oh, wow, you look really tan. Like, you look like you've been in the sun. And I thought about that, and I believe one of the things that you and I are called to do is we're called to spend time with the sun, S-O-N. We're called to spend time with Jesus, to feed off his light. And you'll know people who spend time with Jesus because they have this glow about them that isn't from who they are. It's from Jesus. That's the invitation he's giving us. He's saying, shine bright. Let your light shine before others so that they see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven. You and I are invited to do good deeds on behalf of Jesus so that others can see the flame, that they can see his life and have access to it. Which brings us to our final point, this kind of confusing part in the bottom about the fulfillment of the law. So Jesus basically lays out, hey, these are the two roles for you. I've called you to be the salt of the earth, and I've called you to be the light of the world. These are your two essential functions as my followers. And then we get to this part that talks about the fulfillment of the law. And essentially, Jesus is going through and he's saying, I didn't come to abolish law. I came to fulfill it. You see, back in the day, the law dictated if people were God's followers or not. God gave them his commands and said, you have to follow all these things, and then people will know that I'm your God. Well, when Jesus came and he lived a perfect life. He fulfilled every single letter of the law. He's prophesying here. He's saying the future. He's saying, I'm going to fulfill all this because you can't. See, the reality is, in order to be salt and light, we need Jesus. We're not perfect. We make mistakes. We can't earn our salvations. We can't be good enough. We can't make ourselves light or fire. We need a God who will do the impossible for us. And Jesus is saying right here, he says, I am going to fulfill it. I'm going to do it. It is done. Because I'm going to the cross for you, you have access to me. And because of that, you can shine bright your light. You can be the salt of the earth because of what I did for you on the cross. So if you're listening to this today and you don't know Jesus, if you're trying to do things in your own power, I want to invite you that Jesus died to save you from your sins. Jesus took the penalty. He lived the perfect life that you and I couldn't live so that we could have access to his kingdom and be workers in this thing called kingdom of earth, kingdom of heaven on earth. Jesus invites us to be essential workers through the essential work he already did on the cross. This last verse, it says, for I tell you that unless your righteousness surpasses that of the Pharisees and the teachers of the law, you will certainly not enter the kingdom of heaven. Can you imagine in that culture that was taught to follow rules, what that would sound like to them? It was basically saying, there's no way. You got to be perfect and you're not going to do it. That's like saying you got to be wiser and more loving than Tom and Mark if you think you're going to get in. And for all of us, we're like, oh, well, I'm out. Basically, Jesus is saying, you can't do this. I can do this, and I've done this for you. The work is done. It's finished. I'm going to go to the cross, and I'm going to die so that you can live, and I'm going to give you access so that you can be salt of the earth, and you can be the light of the earth. Your job is essential and contingent on the work that I will do. You don't have to do it. And I think about where our world's at today. I think about the fires. I think about the confusion. I think about the pandemic. I think about all the things that feel so overwhelming to us in this season. And I want to encourage you today, wherever you're at, that Jesus knows. Jesus knows. He's gone ahead. He's prepared a place for you. He knows what you're going through. And he invites you to live as his people in this time, in this season, with the power of the Holy Spirit inside of you. He still calls us to be meek and peacemakers. And we're invited to mourn because he comforts us. Jesus is telling his disciples what the kingdom of God looks like and what their role is because of what he's going to do. And for those of us today that are feeling, man, Chloe, that feels like a big call, I want to encourage you that you have a God who walks with you to do it. It's an invitation to be on Jesus's team, to be a part of what he wants to do to bring goodness and restoration to the earth. And so just kind of in closing, I want to give you a challenge this week. I want you to think about what it means to be salt in your world right now. What does it mean for you to bring the flavor of Jesus, the flavor of goodness, to bring goodness to the places that you live, work, sleep, eat, and go? What does it look like to flavor everything in the love of Jesus? What does it look like to preserve, to heal, to bring in the goodness of God to places that are broken and hurting and need restoration? And what does it look like for you to make people thirsty for Jesus? What does it look like for you to lead people to the living water and give them what we've all desired since the day we were born, living water? And I also want to encourage you, what does it look like for you to shine bright? How are you doing being a safe refuge for people in this season? How are you doing speaking the truth, bringing things to light, being truthful about who you are and where you make mistakes? What are we doing to be honest in this season and to bring the truth of who Jesus is and what he did to light? And lastly, what does it look like to point others to Christ with your actions, with your truth, with your love? The favorite song of little kids in my community where I was from is "This Little Light of Mine, I'm Gonna Let It Shine." What does it look like for you to let your light shine and to bring people to hope that they might not have in this season? This season's been really hard on a lot of people. And I think there's a lot of people out there that need hope. They need something to hang on to in this. And Jesus says, you get to be the light of the world. You get to bring them my hope that I died to give them. And so the reality is you and I are invited to take our place, to take our roles, to be essential workers in the kingdom in this time and in this season. And we can only do it because of what Jesus did on the cross. Because he fulfilled the law, you and I do not have to fulfill the law. We can't. We're imperfect. We make mistakes every day. But we get invited to be on God's team to bring his goodness to this earth. I hope wherever you are today that that's encouraging to you. I hope you know that there's grace and forgiveness for anything you've done. If you don't feel like your salt, if you don't feel like your light, I want to encourage you that God sees you that way. When he speaks this, he doesn't speak as a hypothetical. He says, you are the salt of the world. I've made you this. You are the light of the world. So I want to encourage you today to be salt. One of the properties of salt is that it scatters. I rarely ever go to a place and I'm like, can I get a salt burrito? Hold the guac. No, too much salt in one place isn't good. Actually, even in the Dead Sea, there's so much salt and it's actually dangerous. So they give you rules before you go in the Dead Sea. They say, whatever you do, do not flip over. It can't touch your face. If that salt gets in your eyes, it's so concentrated, it'll burn, it will sting. There's rules about too much salt. So the property of salt is that it scatters. How are we doing scattering throughout our community? Being in places where there is no salt, where people don't know Jesus, where there's no hope. What does that look like for you to scatter? And then on the flip side, the property of light is the more light you have, the brighter it is. What does it look like for you in this season to be light with others? Maybe it's getting on a Zoom life group or a Zoom women's Bible study. Maybe it's meeting at your life group in someone's backyard. Maybe it's going to the first church service that we have outdoors. Whatever it is, God does call us to be community and to share our light, whether that's online or in person. You and I were made for community, to be a light together. So I want to encourage you today and bless you and say you are salt of the earth, you are light of the world, and God's called you to play a role in this time, in this place. And as we close today, I want to pray for you that you would have a sense in your spirit of what that looks like. Who is God calling you to, and where is God calling you to go, and what does it look like for you to be blessed by poor in spirit, by being a peacemaker, by being merciful, by being persecuted? What does that look like for you this week? Let's pray and invite God into that. Heavenly Father, I thank you that you have a role and a place for us, Father. And so I pray right now that whoever's listening, whoever's watching, Lord, that you would reveal to them what it looks like specifically for them to be salt and light based on what Jesus Christ did on the cross, that you've paid the penalty, Lord. We are now free to live for you and the love that you offer the world. Would you show us what it looks like this week? And would you empower us to be salt and light in this place, in this season? In Jesus' name, everyone said, amen. Thanks so much for joining.
Take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to thee. Take my hands and let them move at the impulse of thy love, at the impulse of thy.
Sing to
Well, thank you again for being with us online today. I also want to congratulate you if you were someone who made a first-time decision to follow Jesus. We've had several people make commitments in this season, which is so exciting, and we just want you to know we are praying for you. If you made a decision to follow Jesus at any point during our service or would like to know more about what it means to follow Christ, let us know so we can have a pastor follow up with you. You can email us at the address below, or you can text DECISION to the number 52855. And don't forget to follow us and stay in the know with our CA socials and our Christian Assembly LA app. Now let me close our time with this benediction from 2 Thessalonians chapter 3. Now may the Lord of peace himself give you peace at all times and in every way, and the Lord be with all of you. God bless you. See you next week.